All right, so thank you so much, Chef Mesnier, for being on our Tin Roof Project here at Tales from the South. So you say at the beginning of your story that you were inspired by the stars on the wrought iron stars on the gate, right, as you entered for the first time.
Yes.
So what are some of the other things that you were inspired by?
You know, I'm totally consumed by my profession. You know, all this creation didn't happen by accident. Wherever I walk through somewhere, I look at something like here, you have all this painting. If I would have a few beer and maybe something stronger, after looking at this painting, I probably could come out of here with 5 different desserts. I'm talking about the design of a dessert. Now, the rest come later, the flavor, the everything. It's, if I go through a store, I look at things, the same thing, shapes and everything, for me is not a dessert. And I've been consumed. You know, it's not rare for me to wake up in the middle of the night and there is a dessert. Now, be careful now. Don't, you know, keep it at that. Sometimes people's imagination go a little bit too far. And so do mine, I must say. So I have to watch out how far I can go here. But just to say, dessert is my life. I mean, my wife can tell you I'm always dreaming of a new dessert. Mm. And you know, when you see what's in this book, you'll understand what we're talking about here. That is not, you're not going to find anything in this book, in magazine or somebody else's books. Or, you're not going to find anything. Don't even search. Because it's only, that was done only at the White House, for the White House, only one time. That's it. This is exclusivity. Exclusive dessert. I don't operate like everybody else. And I've said many times, I don't run with the pack, meaning the other chef, I don't care what they do. I couldn't give a hoot what they do in Las Vegas, in Paris, in London. I know what I'm going to do. And I wish more chefs would start thinking the same. Because you know what? Going out to dinner, to restaurant, is not fun anymore. I'm sorry to say, but we need a little bit of new blood, new imagination here. And it can be done. It doesn't have to be done to that level, but even in lower level, I think we need to rethink a little bit that people are going out to eat for their pleasure, not just to feel themselves. That's the difference.
So out of the thousands and thousands of desserts that you created at the White House, do you have one that is the most memorable or your favorite for whatever reason?
Now, you know what? If you look at this book here, and if you pick one that you like the best, I give you the key to my car. Because it's look at this. This is impossible. They're so different. There's no way you're going to pick one and say, this is my favorite. I can't do that. I cannot. And again, here is 120 pictures of dessert. In my house, I have 10,000 pictures. When I go through my pictures at home sometimes, I say, how did I create that? When did I have the time to do this? But I was much younger, let me tell you. That is a big factor there, you see. I could make a turn much faster than today. But you know, it's the creativity and enjoy, and mainly is enjoy what you do. You know, 16-hour days for me in the White House was not uncommon. And the next day, probably again 16-hour days. Because when I decide on a design, there was no changing it. I don't care how long it would take me to do it. Because I know many people, they have big plans. But when they get started, they said, oh, hell. No, we're going to change this. It's too much work. That's when you fail. You cannot do that. You cannot backtrack when you have a plan. It's like a general who decides to take up the hill, and halfway during the battle, say, time out. Let's go have a beer. Same thing. Same thing. You see, you want to take that hill, you're going to take that hill. and you go home feeling like the king on the hill because you stuck with it. You know, I have some thousands of stories beside my picture. And one of the desserts in this book, I don't know where the hell it is, but it's somewhere here. There was a dessert for the Clinton administration, not the Clinton, the Reagan administration. And that's a basket made of sugar. It's somewhere in the book. I don't have time for that. But anyway, he was there, his basket made of sugar. And we were getting ready for the Queen of the Netherlands at the White House. Usually the state dinner took place Tuesday night. We were Sunday noon, where I was showing to Mrs. Reagan dessert number 3. Means she already rejected 2. Third dessert rejected. The state dinner is Tuesday night, 150 people. In those days, I was the only pastry man in the White House. No assistant, nothing, 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 nothing. We talk about 150 people. When after meeting with Mrs. Reagan, I came down the kitchen thinking suicide. That'd be a huge relief. I said, if the chef has a boiling pot of water, I'm jumping in. This is enough. And as I was contemplating that, of course, my guardian angel saved me by having Mrs. Reagan calling the kitchen and say she wanted to see me again. So I went upstairs to the private quarter, and she said to me, Roland, I know what I want. This is the Queen of Holland, the country of the tulip. This is spring. This is when the tulips are in bloom. I want you to make some basket of sugar. The picture is in the book, you're going to see. And I want you to fill those baskets with sherbet and stuff. And then I want you to decorate the basket with 3 sugar tulips on the handle, every one. You know how much work that is? Have you ever fooled with sugar, some of you here? It's an enormous work. So I look at Mrs. Reagan and said, Mrs. Reagan, this is wonderful. But I only have 2 days left before the dinner. And you know, Mrs. Reagan had this thing when she was giving you the... She would tilt her head to the right. She still do it, by the way, when she appear on TV, not so much these days, but... And I could see her doing it to another reporter sometime, and she has... Bam! The head goes to the right, and she starts to give you that little smile. Ooh, that still bring me a chill in my spine! It still gives me a huge chill when she does it because I went through that so many goddamn times. You know, I mean, my back hurt just thinking about it. And she gave me that little smile and the tilt and said, Roland, correction. You have 2 days and 2 nights. What do you think of that? She put it in and twisted it more than once. So, I said, thank you, madam, sounds wonderful. Made a U-turn, went to the kitchen, and proceed to cook sugar, many pounds of sugar. But guess what? I made it happen. Work like never before. I tear in my eyes, well, more than once. But that night when I went home, knowing that she was flying high, Mrs. Reagan was a perfectionist to the core. And all the guests, they'd never seen anything like it. There was never a dessert created of that kind. I felt like, I don't know, I can't explain. I mean, I was in heaven. I felt good. I felt strong. I felt, you know, pride, you know, bursting with pride. And, you know, that's what gave me the taste of the sky is the limit. As long as you breathe, the sky is the limit. And that's what put me on that ramp. She did that. She put me on that ramp. And I've never been off that ramp since then. And I could not do any other way. You know, some people ask me sometimes, you know, my daughter is going to be married next month. Would you do her wedding cake? No! The answer is no! Because I know myself. I'm going to go so overboard. I want his wedding cake to be the best thing she's ever seen. It's going to kill me. At my age, she's going to kill me. my pacemaker will go crazy. I'm going to empty my pillbox, and that's going to be the end of me. I'm going to croak on the wedding cake. No, I cannot do it because of that. I have to watch out. Everything I do it to the best of my ability. And there is no other way to do it. So you understand now where I'm coming from.
All right, we have a few minutes left for audience questions. So I've got a mic, and it reaches pretty far. But if you have a question, just raise your hand, and I'll bring it over, and you can ask Chef Roland whatever you'd like he said.
Chef Roland, when you were growing up, was your family in the baking business? Is that how you, where did your passion come from in baking?
Yes, partially. It's a very good question. My parents worked for the French Railroad, so they were not. But my mother was an extremely fine cook. My mother would have put many chefs to shame. You have to remember, in those years, we ate what we grew and what we raised. There was no money to go to the store. And like summertime, we had an abundance of fresh fruit, and starting with rhubarb and strawberries. So every day we had wonderful dessert. And I had also two brothers. One of my brothers, the oldest one, became a baker and had his own bread bakery. Another brother was a pastry chef, and he was working for a pastry shop. And at age 13, he invited me to go spend my summer vacation with him in the pastry shop. And you know, when I saw the transformation of ingredient, mixing, then rising of the dough, putting it in the oven, rising again, the smell drove me nuts. I said, this is for me, this is for me. Remember, every ingredient that we use in a pastry are alive. Some people don't think so, but they're all alive. That's why they react differently on the different circumstances. This is why sometimes you don't understand why your cake went south when you were supposed to go north, and so on. So you understand that. So you have to understand the property of every ingredient and how they work to be successful in this business. This is how you can write your own recipe and do things like this. So my brother was very much the guy you put me on track to become. And the following year, at age 14, which was in France, by the way, the end of schooling, remember? That was the end of my schooling, age 14. Okay? When I see today a bum that goes to school until they're 30 years old and they can't steal all the job, there's a problem there, okay? Excuse me for not having a sensitivity about things like these, but, you know, 14, I was on my own. As a matter of fact, at age 14, on my birthday, do you want to know how I celebrated my birthday? Do you want? Well, my mother put us in a car and took us to Bob Evan, and we... No. We had no car. There was no Bob Evan or whatever. Okay? On my first 14th birthday in the evening, when I came to the table in my spot to have dinner, instead of having a place setting, I had a little suitcase, cardboard suitcase, with a string around it. And my mother said, son, there's a bus going through here in half an hour. There's a job waiting for you in the big city, 15 miles away. Have a happy life and happy birthday to you. So you see, do you understand that? Don't come to me crying about how hard life is today, because I will be laughing so hard. You know, I mean, please, this was my life. I left home with a little cardboard suitcase. Probably what was inside was nothing. Put me on a job, meaning doing $5 a month. They gave me room and board, and trust me, it was not the Ritz-Carlton Hotel, if you know what I mean. There was a 3 years apprenticeship contract. That's how I got started. Then after that, from that day on, I was on my own. There was no calling home for money. We had no telephone, and we had no money. So what do you want? They would have laughed at me, said, you want money? What do you want? So, you see, I think life has gone, I think life should improve, and I've nothing against thing improving, but I think we have gone too much on the side here. We need to bring it back a little bit down the middle, okay? Slowly, a little bit. And so that was how it got started, you see.
Do we have another question over here? I saw a hand, yeah.
Chef Roland, who is your favorite and most fun president and first lady to work for?
This is a taboo question, you know. But I get that. I get, every time there is always the question that I get asked. And I answer truthfully, but people don't believe me. I have loved every family I've served. Truthfully. Many people, the answer to me after that said, oh, you became a good politician. No, I'm not a politician. This is the truth. But people do not want to accept the truth most of the time. You know, every time a family left the White House, by the way, I'm doing a new series for, what is the company who's doing it? National Geographic or something. This is going to be a film that's going to be on PBS or something about the leaving of the family, the change of administration inside the White House. And I describe that the same way I will describe it today. Watching a family leave the White House, it's like going to a funeral. That's sad. And I've was part of that for 5 times. And even though if they had 8 years and there was 8 successful years, it was terrible to see them go. And I don't care what party they were from. The president, when they leave, it's their home. When the new family come in, as a matter of fact, you see them as imposter. You hate them. I remember when my first president leaving was President Carter. And I only served them for 1 year. Shortly after they left, on February 8 or 10, I believe that was the 70th birthday of President Reagan, that had just come into the White House. And we were in a East Room. I made a huge cake for his 70th birthday. And here I am standing behind the cake with all Hollywood in the dining room. I mean, Reagan knew everybody, you know. And here is President Reagan standing in front of the cake with his white wine, making a speech. And in my heart, I had only hate for the man. I say, what the doing here? This is the Carter's home. Get the hell out of here. This is the Carter's home. And I meant it. I meant it with passion. And you know, 2 months later, loved the Reagan just like we did the Carter. So you can't answer that question, really. And this is the best I can do. And the same when the Reagan left, and I remember when the Clinton left, we were all assembled saying goodbye to Mrs. Clinton, lovely Chelsea. By the way, I'm very proud of Chelsea Clinton because she was not only a great kid in the White House, but she has always conducted herself in a manner that was so exemplary all the time. Especially during the tough time, during the Lewinsky problem, Chelsea conducted herself like so gloriously in the White House. So I'm very proud of Chelsea. So, but anyway, and President Clinton, I was in tears. President Clinton came and put his arm around me. Can you imagine? Do you think that slowed the tear? And then he said to me, Roland, don't worry. Everything's going to be okay. You're going to be okay. You do good work. Thank you again for all what you did for my family. You're going to be all right. So, you know, this is how close we are. This is why I wanted to tell you, do I have 2 minutes? Yeah. To tell you a little story about, we get very much hurt when the press keep beating up on the president and the family. Because most of the time it's unnecessary. It's all political BS, as you know. And I have a very good, this is a story, by the way, it's not a true story, but just to show you how bad the press can be. Remember, During George W. is probably the one who got it the most. He's still getting it. He will get it all his life. Everything that happened today is George W.'s fault, as we know, and that will continue to be such. It's very unfair, but that's the way it is. You know, during his time, the Pope visited Washington. Remember when the Pope came? And the Pope wear his hat like this. You know. Is that how he wear his hat? There you go. Wear his hat like this. And he took the Pope fishing on the Potomac. And they drove on the bridge. And his hat got knocked off into the water. So President Bush stopped the boat. And the Pope said, oh, let me go retrieve my hat. The president said, no, I'm going to get it for you. So President Bush walked on water and retrieved the hat from the Pope. The next day headline of the Washington Post, President Bush can't swim. Do I describe it or what? Thank you, everyone. Thank you. You're wonderful. Remember, you are the reason I moved to the United States 40 years ago. Thank you.